I know what most people probably think when you say we're going to be presenting a band today. You think like what you knew your neighbors were doing in their garages a long time ago, and they were just kind of playing shows, doing things like that. But I'm kind of going to start with a little bit of our background. We are an LLC. We very much are a business. We generate money. We pay taxes. We have a lawyer. We have employees. And so we take care of all the big boy stuff. That wasn't necessarily all of the case, or the case all the time in a lot of bands I played in. It wasn't until I met Sam, we started playing music together, that Sam said we're going to go about this in a very direct business way. And because of that, we've had a lot of success, not only in like crowd sizes, not only in things like streams musically, but also fiscally. We've had a lot of success, so we're able to have our bank account pay for things, pay for tour, pay for food for everybody, pay for other bands' food, pay for other bands' hotel rooms, but we have the ability to do that, which is really nice, and we can write everything off. Sam kind of, when we first started, he was like, you know, this is very much what I want to do as a career. I said the same thing, and we both agreed that the best way to go about it was that I would write the music, I would take care of the creative end, and Sam would take care of the administrative work. At first, it was like a little bit sticky. We didn't really know how things were going to work out, but now being a year, just over a year and a half, about a year since our first album came out, and in the band world, that is to be able to hit well over 100,000 streams on music platforms to generate the money that we have. We've had a lot of success in that, which is really, really cool. Not to gloat or anything, but in band terms, we're doing really well. So, as you can see, some of our pictures, we take the creative end very seriously. I'll kind of show you our website real quick. We wanted to make sure that everything as far as what was presented to the public was all legitimate. And so this is our album cover. That was our guitarist on his first birthday. Don't worry, he wasn't actually drinking beer or smoking a cigarette. But we wanted to show people immediately off the bat, before we had any fans, that we were legitimate, because in this business, legitimacy builds basically a fan base. So we started out with photography, we started out with music videos, and we started out with graphic design. And we spent money initially to get all of this done, because we knew that if we came out hard and we came out fast, that people were going to believe in it. Weirdly enough, I think that translates. I'm also a community manager here, and I see a lot of businesses, and oddly enough, that's like, you know, when businesses are starting up, is they get graphic design, show legitimacy, get a website that looks good, that's not just like your name and a weird Photoshop or like a weird picture of you. Legitimacy builds confidence in your business, and people want to spend money and invest time in the things they believe in. So, with that, we kind of built our structure off of people working for free for an idea. Since Sam and I own the business, he owns 49%, I own 51%, we basically went to other musicians that liked the music, and we said, do you want to work for free? And some said no, and some argued with it, but we did find a core group of people, three other people, very talented musicians, that said yes, because the idea is that right now you will be working for free, because we take all of the money, we don't pay ourselves, we don't pay anything, it gets invested directly back into the business, so that way we can pay for pretty much all the expenses. We can pay for what should have cost $60,000 album, which is about the going rate to make an album, merchandise, things like that. So eventually, we can do some really badass stuff in the future, you know? And they all agreed to do it. So right now, we have kind of like, essentially, they would be contracted employees that are working for free.
Yeah, you get really lucky that one of them is a very talented graphic designer. So we kind of built two birds, one stone with that one. So.
Yeah, he invests his time in it. He does like really, really great work as a graphic designer. We've been using people's talents as they come. We have a PR and marketing guy that was a fan of the band, and he was coming to shows and said, look, I work at a big marketing firm in Alexandria, and I think I can help you guys. And we said, well, you know, we can't really pay you. We can give you percentages off of shows and off of successes. And so we went that avenue, and it's worked out really well for us so far.
Same with photography. We happened to, approached by a lot of photographers and videographers that are trying to get their businesses off the ground and partnering with us. They don't work.
literally almost all of our success that we've had has come through networking. Just like any other business, this business is unique in the fact that, I guess to put it in a weird way, if you were making an operating system or an OS today, you are competing, and you're just a startup, right? You got five people in your garage. You're competing with, you know, Windows. And how many Linux, like other big companies that are well established, that's essentially what we're doing as well. But on a very, very large degree. There's bands that you've never heard of that generate so much money. And as far as the music industry goes, there's only so much money to be allocated. Hopefully, you interest people more to spend more money than normally wouldn't. But realistically, there's only a certain amount of money that can be allocated. So we're competing against some really, really big boys. But because of the networking and the people that we've met, the people that we've been able to generate money and get our name out there, we've been in the Loud Times now three times. I've had interviews with them. We've been interviewed with podcasts. And so I guess going on to my biggest opportunity, and then I'll say the biggest challenge, that's cool.
Yeah.
I'm going to take the reins on this.
I'm a little unclear as to what exactly you're talking about. You're talking about becoming a production company? Is that open?
No, band.
So this is just purely band.
Yep.
Hey, you know, Kid Brothers playing band.
Similar, so kind of getting into the, so the business is like very unusual. There's two avenues for it, like if I were to say mainstream success that we're making, that we quit our jobs and that's what we're doing, right? Which is looking like it's going to happen soon, that I work with. Basically, the avenues you can go is you can have your LLC bought out and absorbed by a huge record label and they say, we own all of your creative rights. Here's a large chunk of money. If you want that, that's fine. That's not what you want. You don't want to be the Iggy Azaleas that flash burn out really, really quickly. Or you keep your LLC and they say, we're going to invest in you and we're going to create a career musician. That's what you usually want. You don't want to be the pop musician that sells out. It's better to make long-term money in small amounts at first and build than it is to just sell your LLC or essentially get it absorbed by the company. There are several avenues in which you make money if you go the route that we want to go, which is to build your business. You make money off of television and radio. You get percentages. So we work with a company called BMI, and what they do is they give music distribution rights. We give them to people that we, like for this album, we gave people that invested in the album, because it's very expensive to make an album. We gave like 2% of BMI rights. They get a check each month. We get a check each month. And that's through things like Spotify, which you make money from, iTunes, YouTube, Apple Music, and CD Baby, Bandcamp. So that's one pocket of making money. The smaller pocket of making money is actually playing the shows. That pretty much covers their own expenses. It costs a lot of money to travel. It costs money to hold people up in hotels. We just played a show in Roanoke where they said, look, you're playing this show to play a bigger show. It was like a trial phase. We blew it out of the water, of course, because we're awesome. But we only got paid $100, and that didn't even cover gas. But it was an investment. We sold merchandise to a lot of people that had never heard us before, and those people are then going to go to the show that we're going to play because of that. And the show we're playing because of that show is called Floyd Fest, which is huge. Foster the People, you know, Pumped Up Kicks, and man, they're playing Floyd Fest with us, so it's going to be huge exposure. So it doesn't necessarily directly, playing shows doesn't translate immediately to dollar signs. It does to a small degree, but that's not what you're going for. You are going for music distribution and rights. You're going to allocation of funds through thousands of different pockets. Merchandise, online merchandise, somebody wearing your shirt in a movie because they like the design, because your graphic designer's really good. That is how you make the most money as an independent business. Or you get bought out and you sell your soul to the devil, as they say.
So what's the opportunity or challenge?
Yeah, so the opportunity that we had is we won a worldwide competition that we beat out 10,000 other bands across the world to get the number one spot for a song. We made money, we got a lot of stuff from it, but the biggest thing that we got was we got 1,200 names from every major CEO and a vice president of AR of every major record label in the world. We spammed their email, just sent them all of our stuff, and we started getting a lot of hits back. And so right now we're in an opportunity where we're talking to five of the biggest record labels in the world. We're talking to Atlantic. California Sony. So we're at a very pivotal point, which is our opportunity. So, and we're directly talking with these people. We Skyped in that office over there with probably 2-3 weeks ago with a guy that worked that produced George Harrison's albums, David Bowie's albums, and he loves our stuff. He wants to work with us. The challenge is that we have representation, we have a lawyer. We don't necessarily know who is going to be honest and who is going to look at us and go, we can make money, which doesn't necessarily mean it's a bad thing. We want people to go, I want to invest in this because it's going to make me money. That's how any business works, right? We don't know who is going to be, I guess, like a wolf in sheep's clothes. You know, like, also, I would say a challenge would be that working with creatives, we're very business-minded. We try to do our best to carry ourselves in that way while still looking rock and roll, you know what I mean? But like, our biggest challenge is that we work with people who are finicky. These people are working for free. And they complain, and they call me all the time, or they'll call him and say, this is wrong, this person's doing this, and you get these calls all the time. We have to deal with essentially employees that don't get paid, but we have to keep happy, because if they're not happy, you're not gonna play as well on stage. And so I can say my biggest challenge that I present to you is how to keep people who are unpaid, who are essentially interning, happy and productive, but still doing what's best for the business, even if they don't see it that way. I would say that's our biggest challenge. So it's unique, but.
So first off, that's awesome.
Thank you.
All of that is freaking phenomenal.
Thank you.
I mean, in terms of keeping people, so in terms of keeping people engaged, like the biggest thing that I've found across like any type of business is really what is that vision, and then do they fully buy into that vision? And so how does someone fully buy into the vision though? It's like, well, here's your part in making this vision happen, and like here is what the future looks like for you as
right.
part of that ultimate vision. So if it's like getting distribution rights through some major label,
yeah.
right, that you mentioned, could be a lot of money, right? So
sure.
that's one thing, exposure of all of their work, right, all of that. So, but coming up with really what is the greater vision for the business, which is the brand, and then where exactly do they fit into that vision, and what does the future look like for them when you all decide?
So you're saying like delegation of kind of a role, like if you give people a little bit more responsibility in that specific role, and say, look, this is the part that you're playing, this is the bigger idea, if you play this part, it's going to pay off.
So, to an extent, it's a little bit like deeper level than that.
Uh-huh.
So, in terms of like ultimately what you're trying to do with
sure.
the band, do you have a vision for the band?
Yeah, I mean, essentially it's to do it as a career. So, like, generate enough money to do it as a career.
Okay, right on. So, like, what then would that mean for each of the people?
That they would be salaried employees. And I think it would be, so I'm to be honest, I don't even know at that point how we would structure it, but I think the big idea was that the band makes a certain amount of money, and then they're salaried employees with bonuses depending on how well you do with shows. Because some shows you make a lot more than shows.
Right. So what I would look at isn't necessarily like what exactly their role would be, it's like what do you get out of it, like as part
right.
of your life, right? Like what
sure.
does it mean to be
yeah.
a salaried employee with a band that
yeah.
has an enormous label behind them and all of that, like at a more deep level, not just like, this is what you're going to do today and tomorrow and the next day,
sure.
but like, this is what this is going to do for your life and like you as a person.
Right.
Once
show
you get,
incentive.
Yeah, exactly.
Someone
can
make a
journey
if you have a little question, like Tony and Crystal,
having helped that we talked earlier,
yeah,
with
yeah.
the bands in the past. Forget it. You're not, it's gonna be like 30 and kittens.
Yeah.
And honestly, if the two of you,
yeah.
keep it that way.
Yeah.
It's the two of you. Everybody else has been there to help. Everybody else has been there to move you along.
Right.
And quite honestly, just tell them, you're here or not.
Right.
Because honestly, when they start fishing and thinking that you're making money, you're not getting anything.
Right.
To them already, you know, this is where it is. We're not there yet. If you don't want to be on a spot, fine. You'll find somebody else. And as harsh as that is,
right.
it's really what you need to do. do, because they're going to start doing things behind your back. They're going to start doing things undermine you, and it's, no, I've seen it
now. Oh, yeah, we've started to experience stuff like that, very much so. Yeah.
So if you, if the two of you, you have the deal, you are locked in. Everybody else is along for the ride, and they want to stay in that ride. Eventually, one day, they will get commission. Okay. But don't make them sour.
Don't make them sour?
Don't make them sour.
Just commission off of what they like, performance-wise?
Exactly.
Okay.
Commission like for gigs, for 40s, whatever, because of that. Once they expect a salary, then they make them even more ready.
Right, they can get, like, way too good.
Exactly.
And commission only,
they stay.
I think that's smart.
So, Chris at Breakaway Fitness, I was going to go along with what Tony said. I've been in business 16 years, and across all blocks of businesses,
right,
you're going to find the same people doing the same things, and it's not going to change.
Yeah.
So the negativity is not going to change no matter what you do. You can give them a million dollars, and they're still
still
going to be the problem people in your business. It's never going to change. So if they're already being a problem now,
right,
imagine when they start getting more power,
so you're living Pink Floyd's Have a Cigar.
What's that?
The song Pink Floyd. When your dear boy have a cigar, you're going to go far.
Yeah.
So understand what their motivations are. Understand how well your motivations and their motivations line up. Because if their motivations aren't going to dovetail with what it is you guys are doing, then they're on for the ride. They're going to get what you're going to get. And then at some point, they are going to.
Right.
So, but it's really about if you can spend time understanding what makes them want to be there. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, they will stop imagining as long as you can say, "Okay, I get it. I know why you want to be here. I know you want help." But helping is not distracting. It is not. You want to hear your concerns, but right now, this is something you can't change. It's going to be a distraction.
Right. And honestly, just like that, like where it's just like, you need to relax because just trust me. Like I had that talk with them, like people, everybody involved in this, and I was like, you just need to trust me, and like you're not gonna always get what you want.
That's not enough.
So
why do you trust me?
Yeah.
Why?
Here are the reasons why you're doing the thing you need to do, and you can continue to trust that this is how this is going to work, and this is how it will pay out for you.
Sure.
If they don't understand how, then they won't engage.
So, Greg, executive Christian.
Christian
and Sam. So, this is fast and loose, but Christian, I have a job for you and Sam. If you come work for me for free, I guarantee you will be able to read sheep in this book, wolves and sheep further after 6 months. Are you interested in that?
Yeah. I need more information.
Okay, fine.
Yes, ultimately.
Why are you interested?
Because that's a necessity.
To get where you want to go.
Yes.
Right. Do that for the people in your bed.
Right. Right.
Get that clear and help them see. You got to know what it's kind of summarizing what we've already heard a little bit.
Yeah.
Understand where they want to be and how being on your train will help them get there. And keep that in front of them all the time.
Right.
So it's crystal clear. Yeah. The other thing is, some of these people you spend a lot of time with them.
Sure.
Yeah. Some of them play really well. Maybe you get a great chemistry together. Consider maybe bringing them into the deal and give them a small share. 5%.
Right, that's
but
actually
you want to do that with
a lot of reservation.
A lot of care. Because they can become a headache very quickly. But if their consistency and the chemistry is there and you can see yourself running with them, then they become older.
It kind of gives them,
they become older. So that's right.
Thank you very much.
I find that if someone in the band is not the creator, it's very hard for them to see the real vision that you guys have seen.
Right.
So what you might want to do is create certain benchmarks along the way. We've achieved this, and 3 months later we've achieved this, or 1 year later we've achieved this, so they can see the progress.
Yeah.
And then at the end end of those benchmarks, you put out a pot of gold or whatever.
Right, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But they've got to see the progress, because they really, most of the time, do not have that vision which you guys have.
Right, and so we actually had a little bit of success with doing that and like kind of referencing back. Remember when we said this, if we do this over this amount of time, look that this happened, like exactly what we said happened, and then we continue to do that. That's
put them on paper or put them on
right, visual diagram
or whatever, so they can measure them and see that you're achieving those benchmarks.
Yeah.
So are you guys, I guess, being approached by different corporate labels?
Yep.
Are they offering to sponsor you guys as a band, or are they trying to sponsor the company?
They want to, so it's a little bit different. What they do is they, when that happens, they want to sign you. And so they sign you to, you create either a partnership. Most of the ones that we're looking at would be a partnership. We don't want to get absorbed by them, that because we lose creative rights, they go, you do this. They'd be the Justin Bieber. So
are they trying to absorb just your band, or are they trying to absorb your company as well?
Just the band. So they basically create a partnership. It's not exactly absorbing. More of a partnership. So they will basically guide us using the resources that they have, the connections that they have to bring us to a first level.
Okay, and so on the other side, what you guys are doing now, from what I understand, you guys are helping other bands get to play at shows?
If we like them. Yeah, usually like it's the right thing to do is that you get smaller bands that you're like, you got really great music, we have an opportunity right now that we're doing well. Let other people see.
So do you guys think that going forward, if you get a partner with one of these labels, do you think that you're going to have enough time or resources to be able to do both? Or are you guys just going to be focused on it?
At that point, I think at this, for this level, we're kind of building those partnerships and relationships. If we do get to that next phase, then that wouldn't be quite as necessary. We can be a little pickier with who we decide to work with. So. It's not necessarily that we might not have time or anything like that, but we're kind of always trying to make sure that we are using our time the best way we possibly can, especially since we're both working full-time jobs in addition to this investment that we're making. So we have to be strategic with our time. So if we do advance to a further level, then things like that wouldn't be the best use of our time unless we decide that opportunity that would really work out for us, but it's not something that we probably would need to be doing anymore.
Hey!
I have so many ideas, so we'll talk later.
Okay, cool.
I see you.
Yeah.
All the time. But on the idea of your backup plan, really needs to be very well thought out. So there's something in the HR field called succession planning and replacement charting.
Yeah.
Since these folks are not employees and you're not paying them, really is replacement charting. You guys need to write this down. You know a lot of musicians, you've
right.
seen a lot of bands. Say, okay, here are the three positions that we have, you know, the vocals, the guitar, the, you know, the piano, whatever.
Keyboard,
thank you. So who are two or three people that you could approach, and then you want to be thoughtful and say, so what's the likelihood that they would say yes to us? Just like these people who say, yes, we'll come work for you for free.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
And then the final thing, have you done that? I mean, have you actually written it down?
We've spitballed and
not
written
down.
Not
write
it
down.
Yeah.
Right. Create a chart, a
sure.
plan, so that if something happens one night and it blows up, instead of you guys spending a night or two nights saying, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? You got it written down. It takes the stress out for you.
Right. Yeah.
And then the second thing I'll ask is, so you know you have a vision. What are your values?
Like
as a business,
morally?
What are your values? Well, your values for the
yeah.
band, things that you want to do.
So I would say, so one thing that I won't, as a business, and this sounds kind of artsy, but it's not, is we won't really give up full creative rights.
Okay.
Or have them be manipulated, because that's, I think, what makes us unique. And really, in the short amount of time that we've had the success that we've had, and we've had people looking at us like they have been, I think it's because we haven't. I wrote every bit of every part of every song.
Okay.
And so that never that consistency is what gave us our branding, gave us our, you can only get it from us.
So creative independence, that's one of your values.
Yeah,
I think also, and this is maybe where we're getting in trouble with the whole problem that we've put out there, but we've wanted to definitely stay true and reward people who have invested their time. So rather than just saying, well, it's not working out, you don't believe in this, you're off board, we don't, and maybe that's too nice of us, I don't know if we're not being business-like enough, but we don't really want to just say, like, well, if you're not on board, then thanks, but no thanks, move on. So we want to be fair, but effective at the same time.
And that's something with values, you should get people to say, this is a fit for me. Because you've identified what your values are, you've stated them.
Oh, so you're saying for them to say they're the same.
Exactly.
Okay.
Because you've been
nice clear. Yeah, that's a good point.
So what's really interesting is this really reminds me of a conversation that you hear from a tech company out in Guadalupe. And so a consideration is find two or three different business coaches who help put together VC-based companies or fast-growth companies, I should say.
Yeah.
Because you do need to figure out and share with your team members the structure of how they land with you, so they see it in writing and they know.
Right.
Because trust is so important, so stuff is the fan. And then, but if people see it in writing and have it in writing, then they know what's going to happen. So I guess the question would be, have you talked with any of the people that help you with that? This is people who see people that help you.
Yeah. We have that. But we'd be interested in it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think.
Absolutely.
So my answer is kind of twofold.
Yeah.
The first part is, the journey that you're on, you're not the only one on that journey. And you're not the only one that's been on that journey.
Right.
And there are bands and businesses that have been there, and who's where you want to be now?
Yeah. Like which band?
Which band?
Any one of them that's like generating enough money that they can live on it, I would say. With stipulations, but like Modest Mouse, I would say.
Do you know their story?
Yeah. Isaac Rock, yeah, I know this, yeah.
And the reason why I asked you that question is because that will lead you down a path of understanding what's next.
Right, yeah.
And understanding, when we had that phone call the other day with the record company, what does that entail?
Right.
You know, what is the next step when you get there? Can you take those people that you're hiring for free with you? You know, can you, you know, what can you do next with those people? And so you got to build. And so your vision is to be the biggest band in the world, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
However, but it has to be a little bit bigger than that. It has to break down where do I fit in that? And how do I as an employee, and I'll break it down as far as a car is concerned. A car is just like you as the leader of the band. You're driving in that car. And there's a million parts in that car, and every part in that car is very important. And it's in the success of being two-way. And so you got to realize that those people play a role, and you got to understand what that role is, and they got to understand how to help you, either by holding on or whatever part that they play. You got to understand that, because really, you're a band, but you're the people business.
Yeah, very much so.
And in being in the people business, you're going to have to satisfy those people by projecting your vision on them every day. And they're going to want to go, okay, this is what we need to do next. And your question should be, how does that get us to be the biggest band in the world?
Right. That's a great point.
Try to even reach out to Mother's Mouse. Say, hey, there's a good kind of talking and ask them what their experience is.
Right. Yeah, right.
So, go here.
Yeah. So, my turn, I'll thank you. First of all, are your mail in place that you're referring?
Yes. Yeah. Except for Dylan.
Yeah. He's got a mustache.
Dylan's got a mustache.
So,
facial hair.
Yeah. A couple of points there. This dropped out. In hearing you speak and you're presented, I think the movie Walk the Line, the season, I see what the record executive, the brand together we have, is kind of like a deal with that, if you will. Mm-hmm. And the guy says, I'm fine with you, a lot of records, just not in the business, but we're going to do this anyway. If you want to burn them, then you can do that, but we're going to do this anyway. So that was his conviction. Like,
right.
To sing to it, you know, then there wasn't anyone who's going to stop him, no matter what, I don't care who.
Right.
So, the thing was, is what, in terms of, especially if you've been with record companies,
there's sharks, right? And
yeah.
I think the number is right. I'm sure this is not a unique situation. You know, just with creative people and that kind of stuff. That's almost when you said, you know, it's going to be nice to meet you. What do you do to negotiate?
Yeah. Well, that's what we need, seriously.
But, to that end, ultimately it's going to, what's your view here? You're going to have to ask them, what's like, what are the five things that are really
kind of like the core values? Yeah. Yeah. No, I think it's pretty cool.
Very unique. I just finished a book that made a career switch, Dale Carnegie's book, and he really talked about how to influence disgruntled employees.
Right.
And his advice was never to go try to be understood, but rather to go try to understand and then be understood.
Right.
So first he said just be the dismissive, but what else can you do everything? And then let them give them a chance to speak, and then you'll know whether or not you want to project your mission.
Right.
I think it just has to be organic. They had a big part of building where you are today.
Absolutely. We consider that very much. And it's like special to us as people as well, you know, but you know, it's a tough situation. But you're very right. Listen first and understand them, or else they won't be able to understand.
And I just read an article on how Google was supposed to take a company at 100 to the next level, which I feel like that's where you are, making that pivot. She said that it is very important for you to find missionaries, not mercenaries.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where you guys are.
That's a good. That's a really.
Oh, yeah. I think that's about where we're at.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
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 So.
Thank you.
Now, I'm just curious. How many people are you talking about?
Right now we're
right
probably about 12.
Yeah, that are just actively working.
But with the negotiations that we're having. With the labels that we are in talks with, they talked about bringing on another 10 to 15 people between creatives, producers,
touring agents, touring managers, things like that. And they've already said that it's pretty much necessary. Luckily, the labels will be paying those people, which is really cool. They invest in us, and that's like we really love it.
Right,
but,
the 10 people in addition to you two are doing the food.
Yeah, about 10.
Yeah,
right now.
And not 100% free, like Chris said earlier, some of them work off. Yeah, but it's not blind.
So,
Dave,
and
Tony,
and
make sure you're making a list of what you will trade.
Right.
Really clear with each other, when it comes to people, when it comes to the record labels. Because they're going to look for every possible angle to say, okay, we're going to get over here. Which one make sure you don't wind up losing your leverage? Be really clear of what you're okay with trading away.
Right.
And what you're absolutely not okay with trading away. Worry about.
Right. And then give it to like our contracts lawyer.
Well, that too. But also be real clear with each other. It's right. You know what? This is where we draw the line. This is an open.
Yeah.
And understand what the value is to them, because the rule in any negotiation is give up something you can less value to you, more value to them.
Yeah, right. Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I'm sure you're familiar with a particular band that for many years was an open virgin called the Fire Dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So one of the things that's interesting about the documentary that they've done since is they both said the biggest issue that you have. And they've got to carry something in the background of communication and communicating with
it.
And you're at a point now where that's critical. I just gave Jen a book to recommend you to use it called Leadership and Self-Deception. But if you buy a copy of it, it is brilliant at teaching you, explaining you how to communicate with everyone above, at your level and below.
Right.
Because you're at a point now where the tipping point is about to happen. Also, all those people that you knew, trusted, and were faithful to may be expendable, and you need to have explained that to them, but you also need to communicate with people above you, because you're simply worried about looking at the roles you should be exploding, and understanding and knowing how to communicate and not being deceived by your own thought process is critical.
Right.
And this is a great book for me to read through in maybe a day or two.
What's the name of the book?
Leadership. I'll give you the information.
Okay.
But listen to how the community talks about them. And I think right now, that's a very critical point where you're at.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, you're afraid of being screwed over, and everybody from the deals on, and sprayed up, and sprayed. So you guys can structure yourself as a business first, everything else happens.
That's what the mentality we want is, it's business first.
Yeah.
So you got all of these people working for free. How well do you recognize those people?
What do you mean by recognize?
How well do you recognize them? How well do you thank them
for
what they do and reward them for supporting you?
Right. What we touched on earlier, by kind of setting those achievement marks, and really that's the best way that we can right now, is by making sure that they've understood how their efforts have actually achieved goals for us, and making sure that.
So is that a handshake?
Is there Sam's more like
is that money? Is that a check? I mean, what is that?
Sometimes it can be. It's a combination of all of those.
It's also gear. Gear and musicians is huge. When we go, we're going to take band funds. We're going to be
and a lot of the free work that we do. For the people that aren't directly invested, to where, like, our bass player, keyboard player, like, they're along for the ride. They know that if we do make it up, then they're going to be playing the band with us. But the harder thing to reward people for is the photographer, the marketing, the PR, the people that are doing more behind the scenes things. For those guys, I think one of the best tools for us is acknowledging that, like I said earlier, more content is what people like. Us and them were just starting off lean. So the mutually beneficial addition of new content for them, to where they can say, hey, I did work for, in fact, the PR guy that we have been working with, they're working on starting their own management company for musicians and artists. And while we haven't been able to reward them or recognize them financially, if we do happen to get lucky and sign to a label and get to that next step, for them, they can say, hey, look, we were working with Big Brother, we just started, we'll put their logo on the bottom of our website, we'll say, hey, this management company helped us get to the level that we're at now. So finding ways like that to give people
And also royalties, they get royalties,
which
is huge. If they believe in something, they go, well, I just get 8% of this company on this album. They go, 8%, you do the math, they blow up, get a radio hit, they can make a couple $1 million. So things like that. That's like our biggest thing. Not the band. The band is pretty sold. They just want to play music. There's also like little things that happen here and there. But really, it's like there's outside professionals that are the most, of all people that are the most finicky, like the creatives, the outside people that go, well, why am I investing my time in this music? Even if they do, but that's the biggest challenge.
So thank you, everybody.
We
have to wrap. Just
get
about
10 minutes
left. On the app, there is a place to submit additional feedback to the presenter, as well as event feedback. Obviously, grab cards and things like that as well. There are a lot of good questions and ideas. Thank you everyone for coming. What I would ask, we're going to do a business card drawing now. Christian or Sam, I don't know which one you
want. Has the lucky.
You guys want to grab me?
Yeah.
Right. So what you say?
Thanks to Lindley Ghost.
There's one that
you
guys rock.
You're the real rock stars.
That seems fair.
Katie Leonard's here.
We're going to have some funny comments as well.
Yeah.